My name is Stanislaw Robert Liberta with AV Ultra, and today we're going to be talking about lights and shadows in Apple Motion. If you go ahead and open up your project, you should see a background here with some text and a little icon. You can see I've already set up our reflections, so let's go ahead and get started. If we go to our Add Object tab, we can go ahead and add a light. And by default, the first kind of light that we're going to add is a point light. If you're not seeing your scene change, make sure that in your render settings, you have lights, shadows, and reflections turned on. Otherwise, it may look something like this. A point light is exactly what it sounds like. It is a single floating point of light that has a bit of a fall off. So if I pan around my scene here, you can see that it is in front of these objects and behind them, it's very dark. So if I move this to the back of my objects here and move it, let's say, behind this icon, and I twirl around to the front, everything is very, very dark. And the reason for that is because we have a light source right behind it. I'm going to undo and get back to our starting point. If we go under our light control panel, you'll notice that we can set an intensity, which will turn up the brightness, basically, of this particular light. And we can dial it down to 0, which turns out all the light, or we can bump it up even past 400, which is the default, until we really blow out our scene. In addition, we have a falloff and a falloff start. So if I crank up this falloff start, that means my light isn't going to fall off or start dimming out until much further away. If I crank up that fall off, you can see it's kind of creating a Fresnel effect. So here's our fall off start and the amount of fall off that we have. So it is falling off to about 30%, or we can cut this all the way down to create something a bit more dramatic. We also have a color, which means we can actually dial in any kind of color we want to our scene. You'll notice as I'm adding some color, in this case a blue, everything is being tinted with a little bit of this blue. There's times that we don't want our lights to affect a certain layer. So if I open up my project and I'll go to my icon, I can select my individual item here or my group. And under my properties, I can go into lighting. And you'll see, let me turn off that color. You can see under my lighting, I have inherited. Otherwise, I can turn it off. And when I turn it off, that light isn't affecting this particular icon. So I'm going to go ahead and undo that and just go back to where we have our standard light here. And I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to rename this point light for right now. And we're going to turn that off. You'll notice as soon as I turn my light off, my scene goes back to normal. If you don't have a light in your scene will look just normal. Like there is no lights ever in there. However, there is something called an ambient light that's just kind of built in. And the reason for that is if there was no ambient light, you wouldn't be able to see the scene at all. So they have something in there as an ambient light. Additionally, if we go to our light and add a new light, again, it makes our point light, but we can change our light type specifically to an ambient light. You'll notice I don't have a control for that ambient light because it works just like I explained to you before. I do have an intensity though, so I can overall turn down this light so everything has a 3.92% lighting in there and turn on my point light. And so you can see I can kind of mix and match my two lights. I'm going to just name this one Ambient Light. We're going to add one more light here for right now. And this one, we're going to rename our Spot Light. And under our light types, we're going to change this to a spot. And if you imagine what a spotlight would look like, it's very similar to that. We have a cone, and then we have a soft edge. And if I just twirl my camera to the side here, you can see that it looks very cone-like. And as I move back, it works just like a regular light would. If it's very close to a surface, it's going to be very bright. And as I pull back, it dims out quite a bit, but lights a much larger area. So now that I have my spotlight, we also have some rotational controls. So if I put my light up here, I can actually twirl this down and move it to the side. And I'm actually going to duplicate that light and move it right to the other side. And we'll just rotate that here a little bit. And let's go ahead and change this cone angle. So by changing that cone angle, you'll notice what's happening to the cone on my spotlight. If I change this to a 90 degree, which is its widest, it is flat. And if I twirl this all the way down to, let's say, 15, it is a very narrow spotlight. Now this will be great if I want this to be dancing around a scene. And we can animate all these properties as well. For my purposes right now, I'm just going to leave that, but I will change the color to a bit of a blue. Additionally, I'm going to turn off that ambient light, and I'm going to change my other spotlight to a bit of a red. And just like you would imagine, when the lights cross, they do mix a little bit. One last light that we haven't talked about here is the directional light. Let's turn our other lights off. Our directional light looks like just a forward cannon. It's just blowing light in a certain direction. And the way that this directional light works is everything in front of the face of the light is going to be lit up. So for example, if I twirl this down, the light now is pointing straight down here and only down here, anything that's in line with this plane. Additionally, if I turn it this way, now it is lighting straight across here. We have no fall off, which is the biggest difference between, say, like a point light or a spotlight at 90 degrees. We only have this intensity and color. So if I just make this a bit green, dial it to the side, pull down that intensity, now we can mix all our different lights together. But what if we want to add those shadows? To add shadows to our scene, we're going to have to go into our individual light. So in my case here, I'm starting with that point light again. And you'll notice I have a tab here called shadows. And if I click that and zoom out right away now, everything has a shadow. But now it's only a shadow for this particular light. So if I move this around, that's actually going to move my shadows left to right. But you'll notice that I have other lights in my scene. If I want to add more realistic shadows, I can turn them on for each of the individual lights in my scene. Each one of these different items is making its own shadow. It is a bit more processor intensive for each light to create its own shadows, but it is a lot more believable. We have some different options if we go under our shadows as well. We have a shadow opacity, softness, and even color. So in my example here where I've got this bright point light, I can change the color of this light's shadow. So every time that this light makes a shadow, I can say make it purple. And now all of those shadows are going to have a bright purple tint to them. And I can soften those up. So if we want this to be a bit more softer, I'm going to crank this up beyond what it'll give me. And you'll notice that that particular shadow is very, very soft. I have some other hard shadows created by these other lights, but my point shadow is a bit softer. So I'm going to turn off all the rest of these right now because they're a little distracting. And we just have our point light. And you'll notice in my scene that I have something interesting happening. If you remember when we first opened this, we had the word shadow here. All I can see is the shadows of the word shadows. So if I go under any one of my shadow text, I can go under the properties and we have our lighting, just like we did for our regular light bulb layers. And we have our shading. And you'll notice it says cast shadows. And I can turn that on or off. Receive shadows, meaning if this was in front of or behind another layer, it would cast and receive shadows, or shadows only. So right now, it is set to, it is neither casting nor receiving shadows. And if it's casting a shadow, as I move this around in space, that shadow is working proportionately. And if I change this to shadows only, now we can only see that shadow. So this becomes especially useful if we wanted to just move a light and have those shadows kind of follow without actually having the words there. So that is a brief introduction to lights and shadows in Apple Motion. In our next lesson, we're going to be taking a look at camera depth of fields and how we can do some rack focuses in Apple Motion. Again, my name is Stanislaw Robert Liberta with AV Ultra, and hopefully you found this information useful.